Morning, everybody. Chair, Dr. Khosla, my fellow panelists, and very distinguished participants here. I just wanted to start by saying that the paradigm shift from growth to growth with sustainable development is not enough. Because we are doing this entire exercise with the same neoliberal thesis. Now you just can't fit in sustainable development goals into the original thesis, which remains the same. So is true for education. Yesterday Anant remembered Paulo Freire. I would remember him again. He said that education can either free person to think and act in the best possible way or educate the younger generation to conform. And I find that everything is going towards conformity, and then we are aiming at sustainable development of the whole globe. So there is a big contradiction, and let's be aware of this. I am not really here to comment on that. My second comment on the set of SDGs set for education as goal 4 and the subsequent indicators which have been developed are obviously because you can't really do anything fresh, and you have to do some out-of-box thinking, and that we have not still done, and maybe we are gathering here to think about it, is that all that you are going to collect information on is the byproduct of the data that gets generated simply by admissions into the schools, the data on infrastructure, and how many people leave, how many children leave, of them how many are boys and how many of girls, and what kind of infrastructure is available for skill building, skill development. And then of course there is a software which talks about what has been the outcome learnings. Now let me tell you that a country like ours, which all of you know has 120 million, we are there very strong, 1.2 and going to rise, increase. We will always be interested in looking at numbers alone. And we'll be very happy to tell you that all of them have been enrolled to schools. And yesterday Professor Leela Visaria informed us in one of the sessions that 50% drop out, and then there is a great dispute between the academics and the government people. And then you get into the issues of how the data is collected, how it is not collected. And I will tell you that in the primary education business, there is no single agency which gives an authentic data. You ask one government agency, it says, no, we don't generate it. It is generated by the other. One doesn't know what gets into this data. So I am just pointing out that in a country like India, which is quite good otherwise, and it's going to be good, I'm an Indian, so no problem. But I think that there are serious problems, and more so in the developing countries. So I'm just trying to tell you that the problem is that the way these indicators are there, and you will read them, and I'm not going to read them out. But for instance, simply like saying that percentage of girls and boys who achieve proficiency across a broad range. Now at primary level, at secondary level, tertiary level, for skill and the acquisition of proficiency, there is an agency in this country which tries to do this for proficiency in language and computation, mathematics. And government accuses that this agency is bogus because it returns with very sad figures on the quality of education. So there, I am only saying that one of the things that the indicator also, and yesterday also it was mentioned, that even the non-official data must be sort of incorporated, as SDGs of this objective is laudable. But where is the credibility of these institutions vis-a-vis the state? And I think yesterday this point was made again. So let's remind ourselves that the civil society is a persona non grata. Now if heads of the states are finally go and sit at that platform and going to argue about this, they will simply discount these things. So now, having said all this, I mean, this is a generic, and I can tell you from somewhere another indicator, and I still read in SDG who is SDSN is here. And let me make a very humble request. You don't start calculating number of extension worker per 1,000 families per 1,000 farmers. It's a disaster. We have done it in India. What are these extension workers going to do? Sorry for aside, Mr. Chairman, but this is important. What are they going to do? These extension workers are going to sell GM seeds and then give all the biochemical and agrochemical agromechanical technologies for farmers to borrow and then finally hang themselves, and this is what we will call an SDG indicator. What are these extension workers from the state going to do? That is the question. I think we have to go deeper. Coming back to education again, I was just giving this example, but please remember, I don't see any stakeholder in this. As I said, it's an administrative byproduct which you are collecting for your education indicators, and please don't do that. What we need to do is at the school level, at least when we said that we are going to have right to education, we did talk about school management committees. And the school management committee has all the stakeholders. It has management, it has parents, it has students, it has teachers. There is not a single indicator which says that what do the teachers feel about the quality of their students. The school management committee is not asked how do they evaluate their infrastructure. Students, of course, will never be asked. There is not a question like India, which is an important, of course, you can always argue that national indicators can be different. But I would still consider in the developing countries where infrastructure resources are scarce, we may have to ask worldwide in all the low-income countries that do they have toilet for girls? For instance, this is one of the major indicators in India why girl children drop out. We don't find that an indicator. So we may be country-sensitive, fine, region-sensitive, but if you had built this indicator from below, that is building set of indicators from SMCs onwards, and then ask these stakeholders to calculate the admissions, dropouts, quality, learning, and educate them on that, and then try to aggregate this at a vertical level, each level, I think it will make more sense. Now, 2 minutes on vocation and skill. Why I said there is a neoliberal thesis? What kind of vocational and skills you need? It simply says, the SDG says relevant, 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 technical, relevant. This. What is relevant? It's a value-loaded term. All that relevance is, which is technology, it's all techno-fix. It's all high capital intense industries that you want to do the cutting edge technologies. And this is the skill you want to put. And how are you going to put in these poor universities where the state is not funding and where you are privatized? The first indicator says that free education. In this country, the paradigm has shifted. Now it is, even in primary, there is no free, there is fee education, not free. The R is disappeared. All is free education now. And better education is free education. And bad education is free education. How do you do this? Now, on this vocation and skills, is there an indicator which says that what is the extent of students' participation and in doing the sanitation and cleanliness work in the campus, in the school, college? How much of their own requirement of stationery, clothing and basic needs are produced by children themselves at various levels, primary, secondary, tertiary? We do this in Vidyapeeth, not very far away. I am now invoking Gandhi. Because Gandhi said in basic education, this is what you are supposed to do. If you don't live together and work together, what skills, living skills you will learn? And if you don't produce the things that you need, how will you develop skills for living? And then you can go on to the higher order and order. Now, these indicators do not exist in the present education monitoring that we are going to do. The sustainability is in the philosophy that I am talking about. There needs to be a big paradigm shift in the way we are educating the next generation. It has to be education of heart, it has to be education of hand, and it has to be then education of head. And we are putting the head down and first, and leaving the heart and hand away, and we expect that we are going to be sustainable. We are not. So that is the contention. That's a general criticism. But we can still do it if we seriously do the SDG monitoring. By introducing these innovative indicators into the whole game, we can still do it. Because then the systems will be compelled to work in the way in which it will produce results. I think I should stop here. Thank you.